Welcome back to part 2 of our digital rock physics workshop. We will start with a basic, or routine, digital core analysis. Topics will be quality control for our digital sandstone geometry, geometric characterization, and determination of the absolute permeability. So, why do we need a quality control? And for which data do we need it? Basically, you will want to import gray value data measured via microCT or any other image acquisition technique. However, any insufficient image quality might lead to significant errors during digital rock analysis. And this refers to both measured data and segmented data. So you will need to check both. In order to support you in your routine quality control workflow, we have implemented one-click quality control features. The GeoApps 3D image report and sandstone quality control will significantly ease your working life. The first provides you with a PowerPoint report for your 3D raw data, enabling you to quickly scan your 3D images for artifacts. The latter checks the reliability of your segmented sandstone geometries for determination of the absolute permeability, following with the approach of Saxena et al. Therefore, it checks the availability of a representative elementary volume, or short REV. It checks the pore throat diameter and the image resolution. And this is exactly the feature that we will look at now. The REV is defined as a rock volume large enough that properties under investigation are insensitive to changes in rock volume and to changes in boundary conditions of numerical tools. The recommendation is to have a structure length of at least 5 times the effective grain diameter. The pore throat resolution is essential for obtaining highly accurate results for digital rock analysis. Saxena et al. Recommend 10 voxels to sufficiently resolve the pore throats for single phase flow. In sandstones, we would recommend at least 4 voxels, based on permeability results for a simple tube with different voxel resolutions. Apparently, the structures differ significantly from the ideal geometry at lower resolution. The image resolution check is kind of a reverse engineering approach. Basically, when knowing porosity and permeability from lab experiments, you can define proper image resolution for your digital rock analysis. However, without knowledge of the real permeability, you can only check if the computed permeability is within numerical limitations. Therefore, Saxena et al. Have published an equation resulting in the colored curves plotted here for various image resolutions. These curves represent the lower boundary for computable permeability using typical Stokes solvers. So, if your computed sample property is close to this boundary, you should not believe in the result. Instead, if so, we would recommend to obtain a new image scan at improved resolution. So, in other words, during the quality control, you will want to have a fair distance between sample property and the numerical limitations for your image resolution. So as shown here, between the red cross and the red curve. Now let's get back to GeoDict 2021. And from the menu bar, please open the GeoApp section. So in the GeoApp menu, we will go to Digital Rock Physics, or DRP. Having clicked Digital Rock Physics in the GeoApp menu, we can choose now sandstone quality control from the Digital Rock Physics features accessible from here. So we'll go to sandstone quality control and we will click the edit button to have a look at the options. First, the project name, meaning that we will create a folder in which we will store all the results. Okay, we will change this slightly to region of interest or ROI 256, because we have 256 voxels in each direction. So that's one way to name your project. And then we see here all the features that are available. It's the percolation path check, the check for REV size, and the check for the image resolution. All of them need different modules, and if you click any of them, or if you leave them all checked, you will also need all the licenses for these modules, which are of course available in your workshop license. Okay, the fluid name here is by default water. Checking this means that you will also have to check your structure for having material in your pores, the material water in your pores. Okay, if this is fine, save the options and run the macro. While it's running, you can observe that at first the grain size distribution is determined. It takes some time. Then the percolation path was already executed. It only looked at the largest through pass from all the possible percolation paths. So this is a quite fast thing. And then it calculates the flow with a minor accuracy. So it's an error bound of 0.1 that we are using here. In case we have a really large and complicated structure, I've also limited the GeoApp to run maximum half an hour in order to get a first estimation. And when it's done, we get the results for our image quality check. So at first we can see here the result of for the average grain diameter, which is for sandstones, a typical value here, slightly above 200 microns. Looking here now at our voxel resolution of 5 microns, we are slightly above 1 millimeter with the NRV of 5. So as I've said before, it should be the average grain diameter multiplied by 5 should be the minimum for your structure size. So it's a little larger, as you can see there. Okay, so the RV size is okay for a sandstone. Then we look at the maximum flow path diameter. As mentioned previously, 10 voxels should it be based on Saxena et al. So we will give it here an orange color because it's below. Nevertheless, it's quite okay from our side. Just have a more careful look than if it would be 10 voxels or more. If you need to have a short look on what all the parameters mean, we've also given here a short explanation for all the features that you have computed here. Okay, so with the porosity and an estimated permeability of 3.4 Darcy, we can look at our image resolution. Okay, therefore we click at result plots and we can see porosity versus permeability. And our sample here has got quite a high permeability at a typical Doddington sandstone porosity. Here it's like 90%. And it is fairly above the numerical minimum that could be computed for the permeability. So we can be quite confident that the computation results that we will obtain with a more accurate computation will be fine. All right, so that's it. Let's get back to the presentation. Sandstone structure for suitability, we will start to perform our digital rock analysis. If you have multiple digital rocks and need to perform an entire digital rock analysis for each of them. Then we assume that you don't want to do the same clicks every time. We assume that you don't want to wait for computations before continuing your workflows, and that you don't want to work at night and during weekends to get results as fast as possible. Instead, we assume that you want to minimize your actions within the software and that you want to maximize your efficiency. And that's why we will now automate our Digital Rock Physics Workshop workflow for digital routine core analysis. So, back to GeoDict. Okay, so first we want to minimize the result viewer. And then we go to the GeoDict menu bar. We select the macro menu. And in the macro menu, we'll select Start Macro Recording. Okay, if you have clicked Start Macro Recording in the menu bar, you can select the file name for our GeoDict macro. So we will call it DRP Workshop DRA, just meaning Digital Rock Analysis Routine. So it's one example how you could call it. And we click OK. So there's further options, as you can see, like save macro results to new folder. You can do so if you want to. It's not necessary here. Okay. And now every action that we will perform in GeoDict will be recorded. We can see it now here in the sense on cruelty that's still opened. You can click just record, which would store something into the macro, or run and record, meaning that we will perform a quality control in this case and also record it to the macro. So it's pretty simple to fill your macro with individual steps. For geometric characterization of digital reservoir rock samples, GeoDict offers several tools available from the two modules ProDict and MudDict. ProDict focuses on the analysis of the pore space, including percolation path, pore size distributions, identification of pores, connected porosity, and more. MudDict focuses on the analysis of solid materials or whole rock characteristics, ranging from rock density and spatial material distribution to the Minkowski parameters and further characteristics. In the following, we will focus on connected porosity, the pore throat size distribution from a digital porosimetry, and the spatial distribution of materials. So therefore, I will go back to GeoDict. In GeoDict, the most simple and fastest way to see the actual porosity is to have a look at the statistics tab. Okay, let's click here to the statistics tab and have a look here at the 3D volume percentages. So we can directly see the volume percentage for each material ID and each material. So if you have two material IDs that are assigned quartz, you will see both of them here connected into this one. Okay, just as a note. So we can see a porosity of our ID 0, water, or pore of 19.25%. So that's our porosity. Of course, as we have done also before, there's the other option to use the ProDict module. So please go to the Analyze menu and click the ProDict module. So ProDict from the Analyze menu in the menu bar. Here we will go again with the open and closed porosity. So we can click Edit if we wanna and change the naming from core to let's call it ROI, like region of interest 256, for example. Okay, we are fine with that. And we will click run and record to have it in our macro and get the results. So we see the overall porosity is 19.25% and connected are 9.21%. So there's almost none dead end porosity. Or almost none closed porosity. All right. So the next thing we want to do is use the porosimetry. Okay, we will go to pore size distribution in the porodict section. So from the drop down menu where we have the open and closed porosity selected, we will select now pore size distribution porosimetry. Okay. And here we will click first edit and check if we have all face intrusion sites checked in order to mimic a digital porosimetry. All right, that's fine. Let's run and record this. So a porosimetry may take some time depending on the pore geometry and the structure size, of course. But in this case, it is quite fast. So in the results, we definitely want to see the plots. And here we will get both the volume fraction versus the pore throat diameter and the cumulative volume fraction versus the pore throat diameter. Okay, so we can definitely see that most of the pore throats or in the pore throat diameter distribution, we see a peak here at between 40 and 50 microns of a pore throat diameter. So this is quite a nice structure for a digital rock analysis. All right, the next thing we want to do is go to the MatDict menu. So please go to the GeoDict menu bar, select the Analyze menu, and now choose MatDict from the Analyze menu. In MatDict, we have several options available. So we have the material statistics, material characterization, algorithms, and more for the objects. Okay. From the material statistics, so from the first point in the drop-down menu, we will choose 1D statistics in the second drop-down menu. 1D statistics is kind of a default thing that you may run for all your samples. Let's just run and record this. Default settings are quite good for most cases. If we go to the plots tab in the results viewer, we can see the result of the material distribution. So showing here our solid volume fractions as a red curve and a trend line showing a nearly homogeneous distribution in our chosen geometry. You can also look at this for the various directions. Typically, we want to look at the set direction because this is our flow direction for the later determination of the absolute permeability. So it is quite homogeneous, let's call it like that. You can also click to the first plots tab, the materials. You can again see it's a quite homogeneous structure, showing here now our manual minerals. So probably feldspar, the pore and the quartz, quite homogeneously distributed in our geometry. So you can see this for the materials here and for the material IDs. So as mentioned before, multiple material IDs may have the same material so that it might be interesting to see the both of these plots. Okay, so when you look at this, of course, you want to check the results for homogeneity or heterogeneity. However, for sandstones, in most cases, this should be a quite homogeneous distribution of the faces. So for carbonates, it might be even more interesting because these are typically more heterogeneous rocks. Single phase fluid flow is a basic feature and determinant for any digital reservoir rock, at least if a flow path exists. The Flowdict module offers multiple solvers to compute stationary fluid flow applying the Stokes equation, which may be extended by the Nafri term and or the Brinkmann term. The latter is important for consideration of microporosity. Typically, the flow is computed based upon input of a pressure drop. Alternatively, also an average velocity of flow rate may be applied. The image on the right shows a sample geodetic visualization of a flow field that's computed with a Flowdict module for a digital Berea sandstone. Let's have a short look at the numerics. The applied Stokes equation is shown without color coding and will be extended if the Navier term is selected and or a microporosity is defined by the user, which adds the Brinkmann term. The Flowdict module offers three solvers, the EJ solver, the simple FFT solver, and the Lear solver. For digital reservoir rocks, we recommend usage of the Lear solver, but anyway, feel free to test the other ones. As you can see in the upper figure, the EJ solver may only be applied for linear Stokes flow without a microporosity, while the simple FFT and Lear solver may both be applied in the given Navier-Stokes-Brinkmann range. The image below is a short reminder on when to apply which equation. So basically, you would only have to change from Stokes to Navier-Stokes in case of non-linear flow regimes. For more information on the geodetic solvers, please also have a look at our citable technical report on our website. The Lear solver applies a mesh coarsening in voxel-based geometries. The adaptive grid makes the Lear solver extremely fast, especially for highly porous structures. Due to further numerical optimizations, the Lear solver is the most efficient solver I've seen so far for computation of permeability, not only for highly porous structures but also for digital rocks. The additionally decreased memory requirements render the Lear solver your tool number one, because you may use larger geometries than any other solver with your given hardware. The image shows the adaptive grid computed for digital Berea sandstone. This quite advanced solver has been developed by Sven Linden, one of our workshop coaches, in the chat. Let's look at an internal benchmark to give you an idea on the speed of the Lear solver. We have computed the absolute permeability for sandstone geometry at dimensions of 2000 voxels in each direction, meaning 8 billion voxels in total. With a high numerical accuracy of 99%, the Lear solver computes the permeability in only 4 hours, which is more than twice as fast as other solvers. The requirements in working memory are factor 6 less than those of typical flow solvers. There are multiple boundaries to consider for flow computations. So at first, the most important is the inflow and outflow boundaries, so here shown in red. Secondly, it's the behavior of the pore solid boundary in the geometry, so like here. These may be slip or no slip conditions. And third, the behavior of the tangential boundaries, so here shown in black. On the sides orthogonal to the flow direction. I want to focus here now on the boundary conditions in flow direction. Among these, there are periodic, periodic with inlet and outlet, and symmetric. So the periodic one, as stated here, it's not suitable for rocks. You can see it here in these images. With periodic boundary conditions, the structures are copied on each side of our original geometry, and thereby we get totally wrong flow paths. As you can see here, so the paths get closed by this periodic boundary condition. And secondly, we have here the periodic boundary condition with inlet and outlet. These add some pore voxels on each side in flow direction. Thereby we get more realistic and expected flow fields. With a symmetric boundary condition, we get nearly the same result than with the periodic, with the inlet and outlet. The thing is here that we copy our structure, not upon and above, we mirror it. Therefore, of course, we have to add more voxels to our working memory. So this is a slightly higher memory usage here. So typically we recommend to use the periodic boundary condition with inlet and outlet. The question is when to use which boundary conditions. Therefore, we have given you into the handout here these recommendations. So for rocks, you can use the flow boundary conditions periodic with inlet or symmetric, both is possible. And for the tangential boundary, so orthogonal to the flow direction, you can use either the symmetric one or the periodic one. So anyway, if we use a representative elementary volume, we assume that the tangential boundary conditions will not affect our computation in flow direction. Of course, there's also here the no slip condition in the tangential direction. So this is basically what you will want to set if you want to recompute an experimental setup. Now let's get back to GeoDict 2021 and perform a flow computation by looking at all the solver options. So first we want to select the floating module. You will find this from the menu bar via predict. So in the predict menu, please choose floating. Having done so, we go to the floating section. And here you will find in the drop-down menu all the available solvers. So we want to use the Lear solver, and the Stokes solver typically is fine for us, so we'll go with that one. Okay, let's click Edit to see the solver options of the Stokes Brinkmann Lear solver in FlowDict. So Brinkmann is always added here as term, but it is only applied if you set a porous face with a microporosity. So we will not talk about the computation of Brinkmann today. But please ask your questions in the chat. Okay, first thing in the constituent materials is that we need a fluid in our pore space. So we have already set water as the fluid, so everything's fine here. So we can directly move to the boundary conditions. Here we can first see the computation direction, so it will be the set direction, which would typically account to the vertical permeability. If you also want to have the horizontal permeability, you can click X and Y. We will leave these unchecked for now. The boundary conditions in flow direction, so we have just talked about them. We want to use periodic with implicit inflow region. So we have this clicked and we will go with the typical 10 voxels added to the inflow and the outflow region. As a pressure drop, we can go with the default value. It's not that crucial here. So the permeability will be independent of the pressure drop in a Stokes computation. The boundary condition in tangential direction, as stated before, is it should be it should not matter if you choose parallel or symmetric. But of course, you want to have no slip condition if you want to resimulate experimental conditions. So we will leave it with a periodic one, which is quite fine for us. What you will see here is a pore solid boundary condition slip length. So you can choose to have not the standard no slip condition, but a slip condition. But that's not what we want to do now. As the next thing, we will go to the solver options in the solver tab. And here you can see at first the error bound set to 0.1, which is still the settings that we used in the sandstone quality control. So we want to go back to an 0.01, which will take, of course, longer time to compute. You can choose here to have the setting for the flow permeability or also for the flow and tangential permeability, which will just take longer. So flow permeability is just fine here as the setting. So the maximal runtime is something you might want to set if you want to have a result overnight. But if you want to have specifically this error bound, so 1% error or 99% accuracy as set here, you want to uncheck this. Okay, so analyzed geometry is something that you always want to set, because it checks if there is a through path in your geometry. So everything else is quite fine. It's the default settings and they are quite educated. If you want to know more about the equations, just have a quick look at what's applied here. So basically that's it. Click OK to save the settings and then run and record. Now the computation is stored in our macro and it's initialized. So the flow field is now computed for our structure with 256 voxels in each dimension with an accuracy of 99%. And as the flow is computed, you can see here in the diagram how the convergence or how the permeability evolves with a number of iterations. Typically, the remaining time gives you an idea on how long the computation may still last. So it seems to finish quite soon. So probably you will have a larger workstation which you're using for the workshops. You will have your result maybe already. Okay, so we have used 1 minute and 30 seconds for the computation here. So first thing that you see is the permeability in SI units. So typically we want to have it in Darcy or millidarcy for reservoir rocks. Okay, let's just choose millidarcy. And it's applied. And it's also applied in the macro, which is quite a nice thing here. Okay, so we have 3.3 darcies or 3,300 millidarcies as the permeability of our sample. And we can see the error bound tensor. So it's 1% or 0.9% accuracy in flow direction. And it's also quite nice for the tangential directions. You can see further statistics down here. You can see, for example, the memory usage and other things. So this memory usage, you can also estimate it by clicking this estimate memory button that you can see here in GeoDict. Using this might help you a lot in choosing the size of your structure. So if you have a limited working memory available, please have a look if it's enough for your computation before you run into troubles during the computation. Okay. You can also have a look at the plots, so you can see the
pressure drop, which is linear for, or quite linear for, homogeneous structures and increasingly nonlinear for increasingly heterogeneous structures. You can also see the convergence criterion, the curve that you have seen before, looking at how the permeability converged through the simulation. Okay, so basically that's it. And now we want to end our macro recording. Okay, please click macro from the menu bar and end macro recording. So the next thing is what we want to do is get our digital rock physics workshop workflow into the menu bar. So we will have to open our project folder. Okay, just open another Explorer. You can also click Windows and E to open Explorer, or if you're not on the Windows but in Linux, you will do it otherwise. Okay, so we want to get now into our GeoDict installation folder. Ah, but where is this? Okay, the first thing we want to do is find out where's our installation folder. So please go to GeoDict, open the console with the small button on the right corner here, and type here GD, and you will get a lot of commands that are available in GeoDict. We want to use the command gd.getInstallationFolder. So just type gd.getIn and you will already see the command that you want to execute and execute it. So I have done a local installation here of GeoDict 2021. So just copy this one and insert it in your Explorer window. And you are in the GeoDict installation folder. So that's one way how to get there. And we want to go into the GeoApp folder now and create here a new folder. Okay, so right click here in and new folder. We want to name this new folder now DRP workshop. So the next thing is we want to copy our macro from our project directory here in. So, okay, what's our project directory? Typically, it's my first GeoDict project in documents. Okay, just move through from documents to my first GeoDict project and DRP workshop. And there we will have some Python file. Yes, DRP workshop, DRA routine. We will copy that one. Go back to our previous folder, go back into the DRP workshop folder, the one that we've created, and we will copy it in there. Okay, so you don't necessarily need to follow all these steps now, just keep it in mind and try it yourself with your own macros. Okay, now that it is here, we can also see it in GeoDict, but not in the one that we've currently opened. We need to open a new one in order to load this correctly. So you can right click here on the taskbar icon and click another GeoDict 2021. So we will open a second GeoDict. We will go from the menu to the GeoApp section and we already see DRP workshop here. Quite nice. Clicking this, we can find our DRP workshop DRA routine here. And that's how you can get all your individual GeoDict macros into this section here, so that you can perform it more easily and quickly, or even your colleagues can perform them, which is quite a good thing here. So just one thing to note, some macro commands may be sensitive towards material IDs, so please try to execute them if they are working for your cases. Okay. So let's get back to our presentation.
It's time for a break. We will continue in exactly 10 minutes. And until then, you have time for questions or more questions and grabbing a coffee or doing anything else.